Hello, Internet. I've been seeing numerous questions going around about mRNA vaccines, a mix of curiosity and uncertainty, and there's just a lot of information available. I wanted to make a quick video about what viral infections do and how mRNA vaccines work at a really foundational level to hopefully alleviate some confusion and develop context for understanding the technology and vaccination for people who are curious. I'll start with some basic biology and viral infections, which will lead the way into understanding mRNA vaccines. One of the first things we learn in biology is the central dogma. DNA gets read into RNA, and RNA gets read into proteins. The central dogma is complicated by the fact that there are actually numerous kinds of RNA which perform a diverse set of functions. Messenger RNA, or mRNA, however, has tags on either side of the coding region that instruct the cell that this RNA is meant to be read and generate a protein. mRNA follows the basic rules of the central dogma. And when we talk about protein in biology, we're not just talking about the building blocks of muscle. Muscles grow by generating new cells, which require protein as the building block of nearly every aspect of their function. From metabolism to reproduction and maintenance, every process involves protein at some or every step. Viruses are also made of complexes of proteins, and it's unfamiliar proteins that our immune system is able to recognize and mount a response to destroy. Taking a look at SARS-CoV-2 infection, many of us have seen an illustration similar to this one, showing the outside protein capsid of a virus, which actually contains within it its own set of RNA genes. These genes have two main goals: to shut down normal cell function and to replicate rapidly, creating new copies of the virus capable of going on and infecting another cell. When encountering a normal cell, SARS-CoV-2's dangling proteins, called spike proteins, recognize the ACE2 protein receptor found on the outer membrane of cells that line some of our organs like throat, nose, and lungs. The spike protein binds to ACE2, tricking ACE2 into inviting the virus into the cell, where it releases its genome and recruits the cell's molecular machinery to read its RNA, create proteins, and generate numerous copies of itself inside the cell. As these rapidly build up, the cell dies, permitting release of hundreds to thousands of new viral particles into the surrounding tissue, each of which are able to infect new cells, leading to an exponential growth of the virus inside its unprepared human host, while the immune system takes a few days to a week to begin mounting its maximally effective response. This maximally effective immune response is called the adaptive immune response, as in learned or adapted to the specific proteins of the virus it targets. Strong adaptive immune response will prevent reinfection with the same virus, and a successful vaccine seeks to avoid illness but still allows us to build this adaptive immunity and either prevent the first infection by its target virus or significantly decrease the sickness severity if that person does become infected. So how do we generate an mRNA vaccine for a virus then? It began when scientists quickly sequenced the genome of the virus, which was aided by years of research into closely related coronaviruses like SARS and MERS. Part of why this coronavirus is so effective at spreading is how good its spike protein is at binding to human ACE2 and getting into our cells, so it's a good choice for what viral protein we want to target with vaccination. In a test tube full of the building blocks of RNA then, we input that sequence, generate the RNAs we want, including tags to make it mRNA so the cell knows to turn it into protein. Is then coated in a layer of fats or lipids that will allow it to easily enter human cells. This lipid-coated mRNA is the basic unit of an mRNA vaccine. Additional non-reactive things like salts and sugars are also in the vaccine for stability during storage and transportation. And if you've heard there are nanoparticles in the vaccine, it's actually just these fats, which have slightly altered chemical structure to help them protect the mRNAs from degradation until it is time for them to be read inside the cell. And fats like these are easily broken down inside the body. We'll look again at a healthy cell, this time receiving the mRNA vaccine. The lipid coat allows it to enter the cell membrane and pushes mRNA into the cell cytoplasm. The cell reads the mRNA and generates only the spike protein, since there are no instructions for making the rest of the virus. RNA typically degrades within a few hours inside the cell, while the cell has a few mechanisms to either now present the protein on the cell surface as a suspicious foreign protein, or release it completely. By one or some combination of mechanisms like these, immune cells can detect the foreign spike protein, which then traverse to the lymph nodes and prime an adaptive immune response. This includes the generation of antibodies by B cells and proliferation of professional killer immune cells called T cells. If a strong adaptive immune response is generated, the next time the body encounters the virus, circulating antibodies that recognize it will surround the virus, blocking the spike proteins from binding to ACE2 and marking it to be destroyed. At least as important is that if it does make it inside the cell, as it begins to generate new copies of itself, the cell will again show suspicious proteins on its surface. This time around, when recognized, T cells will pump out death signals to the cell. This will tell the infected cell to destroy itself, including anything inside it, to stop the production and spread of the virus. It's this tag team work of antibodies outside the cell and T cells surveying suspicious proteins that can prevent that runaway exponential spread of the virus, or even stop it completely before infection begins. Lastly, I wanted to talk generally about vaccination, including mRNA vaccines. Vaccination began originally using live viruses, one of the first being protection against smallpox by infection with the related cowpox virus, vaccinia, which is where vaccines got their name. Giving the largely non-fatal cowpox virus provided immunity to the extremely deadly smallpox virus. A benefit of this method is gaining strong immunity due to a full immune response to a pox virus, but of course you actually also got sick as the vaccinia virus ran its course. This led to vaccination with dead or inactivated viruses, which led to the eradication of numerous diseases like polio, and is often used in influenza vaccines. This is a huge category of vaccine types, and typically includes an immune response to all or part of a virus. The immune response can sometimes be weaker, but adding more parts of the virus to make it stronger can carry a risk of the virus replicating or causing illness. This requires significant testing and tuning for each vaccine being developed, taking a significant amount of time for development to ensure both safety and effectiveness. mRNA vaccines have not been used in humans before, but not for lack of efficacy or ability. An immediate need just hadn't arisen until the emergence of COVID-19. mRNA vaccines can be extremely rapidly developed, as quickly as 2 or 3 months, with tight control over what is in the vaccine due to the nature of creating our own RNAs in a test tube. They also carry no risk of replication, due to no genomic DNA or RNA in the vaccine. They never enter the nucleus of the cell, and are tagged as mRNA to designate their role as protein scripts. We knew at a theoretical level these vaccines should work in humans, almost certainly very well, and that has consistently been the case in numerous animal studies. With the vaccines developed for COVID-19, they were administered in small, carefully controlled studies, and now have passed safety in large clinical trials with the data being published this month. We'll look here at some of that data, published for the vaccine developed by BioNTech with Pfizer. New infections are shown by going up on the y-axis, and time is shown moving to the right on the x-axis. The red line represents people receiving a placebo, and the blue line people who received the vaccine. The data shows that the mRNA vaccine provides on the order of 90 to 95% protection from infection with SARS-CoV-2. About 10 days after vaccination, time for the adaptive immune response to be generated, we see that the two groups split. The number of people in the vaccinated group catch COVID-19 at a significantly lower rate, only about 5 to 10% as often, with no apparent drop-off over time in the 2-month window collected so far. We were looking for a vaccine that provided at least 70% protection. This data is even better than what we needed, and by a lot. That said, I skipped over a point that I want to emphasize as a growing issue for the effectiveness of vaccines in many Western countries. I highlighted the specificity of mRNA vaccines, but it holds true for all of adaptive immunity. Only the content or code of specific proteins are in any vaccine or virus, and the immunity we gain is limited to those specific proteins. If a virus isn't making proteins that we have adaptive immunity built up against, then that virus has a lot of time in our bodies to replicate, spread, and make us ill. And the more times a virus replicates, the more chances it has of mutating beneficial new ways to enter cells or evade immune detection. The spike protein was chosen for mRNA vaccines because it is so good at entering cells. The chance of that spike protein mutating well is small. Any changes will likely make for a weaker, less effective virus, and natural selection tends not to favor proteins that are inferior in their role. In places where nearly everyone receives the vaccine, SARS-CoV-2 is almost certain to die out. However, the chance for a new spike protein evolving that isn't recognized by the current vaccines or adaptive immune systems of people who already got the virus, it increases when fewer people are vaccinated. Fewer vaccinated people means more comfortable hosts for SARS-CoV-2. More hosts means more replications, and more replications means more chances for beneficial mutations for the virus to accumulate. High rates of vaccination can obliterate diseases, like smallpox, measles, mumps, rubella, polio. Nightmares of the past. They're just old stories to so many of us today. Viruses go extinct without good hosts. Viruses evolve new tricks when there are susceptible bodies. In the West, we hold personal freedom to be a self-evident, nearly inalienable right. Liberty or death. We are also members of a society. To protect our right to liberty, we need to protect the right to be alive, to protect the continued health and function of the society that guarantees that liberty. Not everyone can get vaccinated. There are serious medical conditions that prevent it. The immune system is complicated, and genetic bad luck or unavoidable illness can make vaccination risky for some people. These are the same people who will almost certainly die when they get COVID-19 if it's able to continue spreading wildly at pandemic proportions. More than 90% of us, however, have healthy immune systems, even just functioning immune systems. Immune systems that will take a vaccination and embrace it, get stronger. The vaccine has minimal side effects. Tens of thousands of people have received it. The most common side effects are mild fatigue and a headache for a couple days, maybe swollen lymph nodes. That's mild discomfort for maybe a day or two. Serious side effects we expect to be possible from an mRNA vaccine would show up in a two-month window, which is why clinical trials need it to run that long, and serious side effects are just not apparent in the data. If you don't already know that you can't receive the vaccine, you can probably receive the vaccine. This is, of course, a conversation to have with your doctor, who with you knows your medical status. But with broad vaccinations, we can protect the life of our society and the liberty of the people that we hold most dear. With the vaccinated population, we can go back to enjoying our personal freedoms, to having liberty outside of our houses, with our friends and families, without the fear of catching, spreading, or dying from COVID-19. It is just around the corner, with a majority vaccinated population, that COVID-19 can join the nightmares of previous generations as a disease that used to exist. With that being said, I appreciate you taking the time to watch, and I hope that this helped fuel a better understanding of viruses, mRNA vaccines, and vaccination. I look forward to seeing many of you, my family, and friends on the other side of COVID-19. Thank you.